So thank you very much. Thank you all for being here this afternoon. First, let me apologize because my colleague Jose Alonso was not able to attend this conference, so it's my duty to do it today this afternoon. So the title is about explaining the unexplainable AI. Basically, what we will do is to focus on this aspect of explainable artificial intelligence, which is now currently being one of the most relevant topics in research and also in applications. We will focus on this aspect of the using natural language generation for trying to explain these some models or some consequences or some tasks that AI systems do. Our research center, the CITIUS in Santiago de Compostela, has a number of scientific programs related with AI, particularly one related with natural language generation and, in general, natural language technologies. So we are working in projects and doing research in this topic, mostly in the area of explainability. So first of all, in order to start, just a few examples or a short motivation about this idea of this need of using of endowing with explainability our AI systems. There are a lot of dimensions related with explainability. I will just overview a few of them. For example, we can consider the capability of the fairness in our systems. Fairness defined as opposite to having bias or preferences on some examples of some communities, on some users. Also, AI systems have to be robust or should be robust in the sense that should be reliable, should be safe, should be consistent in their operation. Also, the characteristic of explainability is related with making the systems intelligible, so users or people that suffer the consequences of these systems have to understand how they operate or how these outcomes of these systems are produced and why are produced. And also, it's very important, the lineage. So, and this is a long cycle feature because it's involving every aspect of the design of the implementation previously on the definition of the systems, also maintenance, evolution. So it's the need of having all this traceability of the operation of these systems. To some extent, some people is relating this idea of explainability or in general, trustworthy AI with the general idea of quality. This means that we need to assure the quality of our systems, we need to validate, we need to test them properly. And this is a key issue in some of the applications we will overview today. Particularly when machine learning or in general learning techniques are in this system, what happens with this evolution, with the change these systems are having, so which is the trace we can follow from the initial system to the final system when this is evolving and changing through the time. Some examples features of AI. Fairness, there are a number of examples we could use for showing how bias is introduced in many AI systems. This is a very recent example by Ricardo Baez and Karma Peiro. Any of you can try with your Google Translator or similar tools. In this case, what we have is a translation from English to Turkish language. We have to keep in mind that Turkish language does not have gender in the pronouns. So when we translate, for example, she is a nurse or she is the first person in her country to win a Nobel Prize, the translation into Turkish is missing this gender feature of the pronouns. But when we do the reverse translation and get back to English, the translation has a certain bias, which is due to the data probably with that was training in this translator. In the first one we have she is a nurse, but in the second one the translation will produce he is the first Nobel Prize in his country. So when it comes to decide the gender of the output in this translation, the part of the bias that we had in the data that were used to train the translator are represented in this outcome. There are a number of similar examples. For this one is also very, very recent. It's in the area of healthcare. In that case, there is a company, Optum, with an algorithm that tried to estimate who should receive extra medical care. The point here is that they tried to provide this medical care, this extra medical care, to people that in the future will have more cost to the system. So they try to anticipate this extra cost by preventing, by producing or endowing these people with this extra medical care. So the point is that because of socioeconomic indicators, it happens that black people has lower cost in the health care. So the outcome at the end is that for similar people with similar health conditions, there is a bias against black people that favors white people in the contrary. So, although in these cases there is not explicitly race as a variable in the system, what happens is that this future cost of for each patient has implicitly this information inside it. So, here is not only a matter of data, but also it has to do with the way that algorithms are able to select the variables and to produce the models that finally are used for making estimations. Typically, they are the follow gaining information criteria, and in this case, this gaining information is inheriting somehow some features that are hidden in the data and producing these outcomes at the end. Also, in the medical domain, we could have similar examples, but let's go to the second feature, robustness. In our AI system should be reliable, should be safe. Here we have a couple of very well-known examples in the areas of classifying images and also with different models and with different approaches. In the second case, in the right, we have that the system is able to classify correctly the images in the left, but when they are disturbed, when they are perturbed with this pattern in the middle, images to our eyes are still very similar and should be classified with no problem by the systems. But in the case of using neural approaches, which is the case for that problem, all the features in the right are classified wrongly. In this case, all of them are classified as ostrich. It's important that in this topic of images, we can relate this idea of being robust or being safe, with the idea of hacking, because it's interesting to see the results of this study. It's also a very recent study that was conducted with images of CT lungs, and in that case, what they did was to introduce artificially fake cancerous nodes, and this was able to mislead the diagnosis by the experts, by the radiologist. You can see that 90% of the time they diagnosed cancer when one of these fake nodules were introduced in the image. And on the contrary, when they erased a real nodule, the diagnosis was healthy in 94% of the cases. So we have that at the end, the idea of having safe or reliable systems is important, and we need to build our systems with these features, with the characteristics. What's important for today, which is the explainability feature, making our systems intelligent to understand what's the operation of the systems, what's the outcome of the systems. You know, we have a lot of different types of models. We have neural ones, we have graphical, we have decision trees. It seems that explainability is, of course, easier for the graphical or typical graphically represented models like decision trees, for example, there on the right. But when we increase the accuracy and we go into the black box models like neural networks, precision of course increases, but explainability decreases a lot. So at the end we have the classical trade-off between explainability or between interpretability and precision is now revisited with the eruption of neural networks, or deep neural networks in particular, and the huge amount of new services they are providing to us. So here we have a very relevant or a key debate. The debate here is where we should put the balance, on what, on or why. Why is related with the strategy to know the problems that our models can have. The what is related with immediate actions after a given model produces an outcome. So at the end, we will have to balance between accuracy or knowledge about the processes, because it seems evident that the models that have less accuracy in general can be more interpretable, and the contrary, the models with high accuracy do not have this capability. Related with traces, or we have to trace from the beginning of one AI system to the during the, its life, how it's operating, how it's behaving, it's also a relevant, a fundamental question here. These are the two well-known examples of crash of car accidents involving casualties, and it's not also the point that when we have these problems, and in these cases we have some reliability, some responsibility, legal responsibility of these accidents, has to be given to the car designer, to the algorithm designer, to the people that provided the data, the test data. Is the testing or the validation strong enough in order to account for the use of these systems that will last for many years in very different conditions of operation than the conditions that they had when they were trained and then where they were tested? So where's the responsibility here when there is a failure in this kind of system? Related also with trustworthy, it's interesting to note that we don't need to explain, to provide explainability, or to make trustworthy systems to all the users of these systems. We have to do that mostly with the people that is directly responsible for their operation, because there is a certain transitivity property with trustworthy. Here you have the example of a flight of people flying in that are confident in the pilot, and the pilot is confident in the autopilot, so at the end the people in the plane is also confident in the autopilot, not because they have direct experience of using that, but they are confident on the person that has confidence on that and is a professional that they trust on. Many other dimensions arise in this problem of explainability, of trustworthy. We have also the scrutability, so we should also endow the systems with the capacity that any user or professional or specific users are able to know what's going wrong in these models in order to explain what's happening with them. And so we have a need, a real need, for endowing the systems with these features, with these characteristics. But it's not only a matter of having fairness or having accountability or having transparency in our algorithms, in our systems. We have also legal or normative frameworks that are becoming more and more important in our days. You all know that a couple of years ago, well, not a couple, but almost a couple of years, that the GDPR was informed in May 2018. And there are a number of very interesting, I would say, sentences in the articles of this law. For example, you can see there that any user should have the right not to being to support a decision based on automatically processing. This includes profiling and other tasks. But the point here is that at a given point, any user should have the right of having human intervention in the process. So if a decision is taken only on automatic processing of data, and of course, if this is being done with models that are difficult to understand or that anyone is able to understand how they are operating, this right to the explanation that every citizen in Europe has can be affected by this lack of knowledge about our systems. In particular, it's also very interesting to look at the recital, a part of them, in this law. You can see that, for example, there is even a certain legal obligation of minimizing errors or the risk of errors, also to avoid discriminatory effects. So it's not just a matter of well operating our system, but also a normative or a legal existence of this kind of systems. Actually, there are some interpretations of that with these regulations, all citizens have a certain right to the explanation from automatically taking decisions. So when in any corporation, in any government, whatever it is, the service that is only taking or doing or perform only with automatic intervention, with artificial intelligence, at some point the users, in particular the citizens, will need the capability of being explained why the decisions are taken and how. Even more recently, the European Parliament has published a governance framework for accountability and transparency. And it's also very interesting to look. I have highlighted some of the sentences I think it are of more interest, but in particular, we can see that they even say that, let's say, technical reasons for this framework. They state that it's very unlikely that explaining the steps of an algorithm, making a detailed explanation step by step of how the algorithm performs, this will be informative enough for users. It seems that they have the preference of explanations that are related with the general behavior of the systems. It seems that for them this is more feasible than doing the opposite. From the technical point of view, both things can be combined, and at the end maybe a good explanation of the complete behavior of a given system should be, in part at least, based on how the algorithm that is implemented in the system is working and how its steps are being taken for producing a given outcome. There is also a third reason, let's say, for explanation, and it's also the real need that we have in many applications. Let me show, this is a photo of our campus in Santiago. This is one of the garden areas we have. You see also the sidewalks, the roads, you see the grass and the trees. And we can see there these white lines that are the footpaths that people walking was at the end doing when they tried to move around the campus. So the designer thought that the sidewalks would be enough for assuring mobility, but real people walks optimizes the trajectories and is able to do a different process that the process that was or the design that was made by the technical people. So this has to do a lot with an relevant area in AI, which is business process management, and in particular process mining, which is also related with big data, and has an enormous impact in explainability to some extent. Business processes are related with defining a number of tasks for providing a service or a product. This task should be performed by persons or by any system. This is a simple example. It could be an e-commerce or a logistic chain doing a number of tasks in order to produce a final service for the users. This is the design process, but reality, at the end happens this way. Most of these, not the systems in general, but also the people involved, is able to find different alternatives, different paths for doing the same tasks. And even in this example, we can see that, for example, a key issue like quality check could be avoided by doing a different path in the process. And also, what's also relevant here is that some loops can exist, or we can go from activity to another and back and forth and back. So in this case, it's related with inefficiencies. So at the end, when we have different, or we have an even very simple process, the learning or the mining of this process or the definition of this process could be like this one you have here. This is a real process mined from data. In this case, is related with a health service of a hospital. This is what in the literature of process mining they call spaghetti processes. The reason is clear because of the shape of the representation. Graphical representations are the usual way of conveying information in BPM, in this area of BPM. So it's evident also that in this case, with this graphic representation, no real information, no explanations, no useful knowledge can be obtained. So it's important to have some analysis or to have some extra tools that go deep inside this process and provide relevant information to the users. This can be done with analytics, in particular with business process analytics. And for example, with these tools, we can obtain cycles like the one you can see over there, which is a repetition of different tasks that probably are showing some inefficiencies in the systems. But a graphic representation for these cases, even for simple cases, is not enough. For example, in this case, which is a process in a hospital, doctors in the hospital are not able to understand any relevant or useful information from that representation. So in that cases, this information could be enhanced with a natural language description, like the report you can see below the graphic, where emphasis can be put not only in the process itself, but in some of the indicators, some metrics that can be obtained from the logs of the system. But also at the end of the report, we can also explain what's relevant about the process. For example, this repetition I was mentioning before. So in many cases, the professional, for example, in this case, a cardiologist, demand not only the graphic representation, but also a natural language written or talked explanation of the visualization. So how to explain AI? We have graphic representations, as we mentioned before. We have natural language. We have a number of different options. The underlying idea about all this problem is trying to explain this explainable artificial intelligence, typically the black box algorithms, in particular neural networks and similar. So the paradigm here is how to open this black box in order to show what we have inside. This interest from explainability mostly arised when the DARPA agency in the United States started a program like 3 years ago. This program is interesting that this was one of the motivating examples they used for this launching this idea of explainability. You can see in this case that the classification, this is a very simple classification problem, is in this case, well, this is a cat. But explanations here are pointing to both to two different ways of providing the explanations. We have a written explanation, which is this is a cat because it has fur, whiskers, and claws. But also we have a graphic representation, sometimes providing similar examples or particular features that are relevant, and doing that not in language, not in written language, but in a photo or selecting one part of the image that is relevant for the explanation, this is also a convenient way of providing the explanation. The general idea is to endow the systems with the modules or the blocks that are able to provide these explanations. And the user should decide at the end, not only based on the outcome of the systems, but also in the explanation of how this outcome was obtained. This DARPA project is still alive. Actually, it will end by mid-2021, so we are seeing from year to year many of the results. In particular, in these last years, they are doing the part of the assessment, the comparative evaluations. It's a project that is focusing on, let's say, many, many aspects of the problem, not only the, let's say, the AI-related problem, which could be the models. Of course, they are doing research, and in general, the community is doing research on trying to explain the models. But also, we need to build a new type of interfaces that are able to take advantage of this new information we have to provide. So we have also challenges related with how these new interfaces should be. And what's also very important is not only a matter of computer science or of artificial intelligence, but when it comes to conveying information with convincing, with explaining, there is a lot of information and science that comes from the social sciences, psychology, philosophy, logic. So this also, this aspect of the problem should also be taken into account, not only consider this from a computer science or from an engineering point of view. So it's very interesting to look to the people that has been doing science about these topics for many years and try to use how do they do things and bring them back to our models. In particular, I selected here two examples. Interaction is important. Maybe when it comes to natural language explanations, it's not a matter of just producing the explanation, but also having some kind of interaction that helps the user to focus with more detail in part of the in the part of the information that needs. Maybe we can provide just an initial simple explanation, but after that this should be refined according to the real needs from the user. But also argumentation is important. It's not only how do we link different how we reason and how we combine arguments in order to be convincing with our explains, with our explanations. A couple of examples of how these explanations are built from the area of AI. This is an example that's related with images. In particular, the approach that they did here was to look at morphological or at patterns, at simple features that every human would in general be able to detect or to understand, and trying to build the explanations based on these features. If we go to technical details, for example, for the biology of these birds, it will be impossible that any of us, or which is not a specialist, could be and could understand the information about why this bird is of one type or of another. So at the end, what they do is to focus on these features and try to answer if these features are present or not in the examples, in the animals in this case. And at the end, the explanations will be a number of these features that are the information which was taken by the system for doing the classification. There are also some other lines of research in this area. There are models that try to provide directly an explanation of the outcome directly. The inspection approach is related with trying to understand the model itself. Is this idea that, for example, the European Council is not very, very fan of it. And there are also a different approach which is being producing now very interesting results, which is trying to provide to use transparent models, at least for explaining part of the behavior of a complex of a black box systems. Of course, we can always do reverse engineering. We can just take the input and outputs of one of these black box systems and train with this data a new system which is interpretable, and in this way to use this information for trying to explain how the black box system performs. Two examples of this idea of systems that provide information of locally from the black box classifiers or from the black box predictors. One of the most recent one is this LIME approach, which at the end does not provide a real explanation in language, but provide evidences that the user, the final user, is able to understand, and that may be convincing for him or for her. In these examples, for example, we have a number of features for classifying, for then making diagnosis of one person of having flu. The idea with the local interpretable model agnostic explainers is that they focus on the most relevant features. Some of them provide evidences against, some of them provide evidences in favor of the prediction. And this information is provided to the user, which is finally who takes the decision based on this additional information. The way that this model operates is trying to look for similar cases to the one that has to be explained. Some of them will belong, will have a similar prediction than the one that is going, it has to be explained. Another will have different predictions, but with all this information about favorable cases and cases in contrary, the final user is able to make the decision. It's not only a matter of using words. This is a general approach. This can be used also for images. And in this case, what they do is to provide these pieces of evidence that support the outcome. For example, if we have to classify or to say why do we have a guitar or a Labrador dog or different patterns in a scene, with these models they select the part of the scene that is related with the explanation. In this case, we can see that, for example, the first case, electric guitar, which is the neck of the guitar. It's not, of course, this is not an electric guitar, this is a Spanish or acoustic guitar, but since the neck is similar, there is a certain evidence that this could be an electric guitar. But you can see that the part of the image that is selected for supporting acoustic guitar and Labrador are very similar. So there are a lot of projects, of initiatives in Europe related with this, also in Spain, but I would like to go to the idea of how can we use natural language, in particular natural language generation, for combining with explanations. First of all, natural language generation is one part of what's commonly called natural language processing. Typically, natural language processing is actually the name of the complete topic. It's related with producing automatically text or content from other sources or information. That could be data, that could be data, numerical data, or different or different sources. Do we need this natural language generation? There are some studies and some perspectives that say yes, and we can see that some of the areas, this is some of the fields of application of NLG are nowadays being very, very relevant. For example, the conversational systems, all the assistants are tools that are using commonly very, very in daily life. So it's important to record here that NLG is a part of them. There are a number of different areas, in particularly the data to text area, which is able produce explanations or descriptions of information that is given in numerical data sets. When it comes to the particularly to big data, typically the way of conveying information is the visualization. So there we can have doubts if we need this other area of providing information, which is NLG. We can use many examples of how graphic representations can be misleading. This is a very well-known example in the literature. Here we have a representation about how the number of murders evolved after in Florida they passed a law that allowed people to use their firearms. So here, what happened is that the representation of the data is not following the usual standard that the vertical axis has zero below and upper values up in the vertical direction, but they did it in the reverse way. So what seems here that there is a distance of this number of of casualties or victims actually represented that was an increase. So it can be in many aspects be misleading to have a graphic representation because the task at the end is a matter of the user. So here what we do in NLG is to process the data. Basically, this is the content determination stage, is to analyze the data and extract all the potentially useful information. This information is related about what we have to say in the final text. And after that, we have two stages related with how to organize the text in order to produce text correct, fluent, and that are understandable. What's important in this context is that this NLG approach can be combined with any other model. We talked before that the line model was an agnostic model for trying to provide explanations. NLG is also an agnostic model because you can use it and combine it or integrate it with any other system that provides the information. At the end, what's important for doing the narratives of the text is to have the analytics of the data, the content determination. This is related with the problem. So the rest of the pipeline can be integrated with any other application. Well, in this area, there are a number of examples we could use. But let me just finish with a very simple one where we relate this NLG with explanation. This is one of the tools we have developed. It's related with explaining classifiers. This is a real life example we could use. It's having to classify beers in this case using some attributes. If you do that with a decision tree like this one, which is itself one of these explainable models, we can also integrate with us a written explanation that is related with which was the path that produces the correct classification in this case. So at the end, you can support the classification by explaining which were the decisions in the decision tree that were taken for doing the classification or for giving the outcome of the system. This, of course, can be integrated not only with decision trees, but also, for example, with fuzzy decision trees or with fuzzy knowledge-based systems like this other one, which is very well known in the community called Furia. So in this context, there is a very strong research movement in order to produce not only explainability, but also explainability related with natural language, in particularly we are launching now a European project, an ITN, which is specifically focusing on how to combine explainability with natural language generation. And in particular, in this context, we are focusing on how to explain very different models, black boxes, gray boxes, which is, for example, fuzzy rule-based and similar ones. So just for finishing, the key idea here is that with NLG we can combine, we can use that for explaining different models, different outcomes, different ways of representing the explanations, graphical, numerical, or in other way. So that's it. Thank you very much. Just let me finish with a kind invitation, because we will host next year the most relevant scientific conference in Europe related with AI. So all of you are invited to come to Santiago to participate in it. So thank you very much.
Sorry, I had a question. First of all, thank you very much. It was a fantastic talk. I was wondering, because I used to work in the finance industry a couple of years ago, and one of the things we were doing to explain our models was actually just build, I wouldn't say a more dumb model, but a more explainable model in parallel, yeah, and sort of using that and the features that you get from it to say, well, look, this is the path that our explainable model follows. So therefore, to a certain degree, we can say that the advanced model must, yeah, probably take the same path. And I suppose the question that I'm trying to get to with this is, what is the degree of explainability that you need to achieve? Because there needs to be some sort of a threshold to say, well, this is good enough. This explanation is good enough. How do you decide on what that threshold is? I don't know if I'm clear on this.
Yeah, this is also an important point, because how to validate the quality or to assess the quality of the explanations is a hot topic now in research, because it's not, you cannot do a general explanation which is satisfactory to everyone. It's always very related with the user that has to consume this information or this explanation. So at the end, what we did in that case is to validate that by trying to, in two ways. There is intrinsic evaluations which can be done if we have, for example, corpuses of explanations that can, with some metrics like typically they do in PL, in natural language processing, and using that metric you can see how your explanation matches those in the corpus. This is intrinsic. And also there is extrinsic, the most challenging and demanding a way of evaluating is doing the extrinsic, which is just asking a representative number of people that should be similar profiles that the one that has to consume information to evaluate the quality of the explanations. Quality in terms of linguistic quality, also in terms of the contents of this information, if this is relevant or not, is focused to a problem. So there are a lot of dimensions you have to put in these questionnaires you pose to that people.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. It was great. I read something in the abstract about how to explain black box models such as deep learning or neural networks by means of gray models or gray box models or something like that. Could you explain this a little, please?
Yeah, the idea here is not only gray, but also white box. White box models are the ones that are more interpretable. Gray models are some between. For example, you have a rule-based model. This is interpretable, let's say. But if this model includes uncertain information as fuzzy expressions, this is what we call a gray model. So any of those can be used to explain partially one black box model. In a similar way as the example I posed before, locally. You can try to match parts of the classification that the black box model does with a white one or a gray one that has a similar behavior for that specific area of the space. And in that case, you can use the information from that explainable models for providing an explanation for the black box model. But not related specifically with energy, there is also an important way or a relevant way of doing that is, for example, when it comes to images, you can provide examples, you can provide similar cases to the one that you are trying to predict in order to support your explanation. So you don't need to go inside how the model is working, but to provide similar situations. And in this way, by parallelism between the your real case and similar cases, you can more or less understand how the classification is done with knowing nothing about the insights or how the model works. Because in these deep neural networks, models, of course, it's almost impossible to understand how things are going on, how this is working inside in order to provide information from that. So at the end, this is a matter of comparison between examples.
Thank you.
Okay, hi, thank you for the talk, because for me it was really interesting, because I'm working in the healthcare sector, so this interpretability of models is especially important, because the decisions of the model are particularly critical, so it was really interesting. I just wanted to put another side of the topic, so to speak, to know your opinion, because I think it's important also to stress, and I think it's not being stressed enough, the difference between extracting interpretation of one model and extracting causality. It's not the same.
Yeah.
It's not the same that a factor is important for the model to make a prediction and to say that this factor was the cause of the outcome. So I think it's not being stressed enough, and in particular in the healthcare sector, it's causing some confusion. So.
I fully agree with that. Actually, in this final project I mentioned, this ITN, one of the topics that we'll be working on is to explain Bayesian Gaussian models, for example, Bayesian networks. There was some work in this respect many, many years ago. After that, it was abandoned, let's say, but by now there are not relevant results on how to explain, for example, causal models. This is an important topic to work on now. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you.